وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين واللانة الدائمة الباقي على أعدائهم من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين. أما بعد, we just have about two more sessions this evening and tomorrow. So we're just picking up, you know, some of the themes to be discussed very briefly. For tonight, I would like to start a discussion about bid'at. As Shias, we hear this term quite a lot from other Muslims when they talk about the rituals or the traditions that we have. And, you know, whenever we say something, they say this is bid'at, this is bid'at, this is haram. When we look at this concept of bid'at, we have to realize the word itself, bid'at, means innovation, to invent something new. Of course, when it comes to science and technologies, there is no problem there. We are talking more about innovation or bringing something new in the framework of the religion. But even those, you see, many of them, of course, they are ignorant, they don't know. If they say every bid'at is haram, then even for them to live the life in the 20th century will be haram. Because many things are all new when it comes to our lifestyle. Even to go to Mecca by plane would be a bid'ah. Because Rasulullah didn't went for Hajj by the plane. And so they learned it among them, come up with categories of bid'ah. They say there is a bid'atun sayyi'a, a bad bid'at, and a bid'atun hasana, a good bid'at. When they come to that extent, we say, Alhamdulillah, you know, now we are on the same wavelength, that yes, you divide bid'ah into sayyi'ah and hasana. And so not every bid'ah would be haram. You know, so there could be a bid'ah, a new way of doing things, as long as it does not violate the laws of the Sharia, you know, and if it has a benefit in it, there is no problem there, and that becomes bid'ah hasana. One of the examples, and that's what I wanted to come to, is something we do in the month of Ramadan. Reading the Quran. The Quran that we read. You know, it is full of bid'at. Na'udhu billah, you will say what I'm saying. But let me, you know, if you look at the Quran, the way it was written during the days of the Prophet, even the script was different. And later on, we'll show you an example, not now. So the script that we have now in the Quran, whether it is printed in Middle East or, you know, the khat and the style used in South Asia, this script was not used during the days of the Prophet. They used to use what they call khat-e-kufi, where the letters are mostly, you know, lines, not in a curvy form that we have now. And number one, so that's one difference in the way Quran is printed now. Number two, those days there were no nuqtas, no dots. When you have noon, we know the nuqta is on the at the top. If we have a nuqta at the bottom, we know this is bay. And so those days, you know, there were no nuqtas at all. Even all the signs we have, fatha, kasra, dhumma, tanween, this and that, this didn't exist those days. Of course, for you know, those who are not Arabs or do not know the language, it becomes almost, you know, difficult even to imagine how would you read an Arabic writing without fatha and kasra. But if you just pick up any Arabic newspaper even now, or any Arabic book, religious or secular, you will see they don't have the signs of fatha and kasra. You have to know the language, and you will be able to read it correctly. But in Quran, you will see universally, all the Qurans printed in whatever part of the world, they have the fatha, kasra, dhamma, all the signs are there, which didn't exist during the days of the Prophet. And even the signs of recitation, you know, waqf lazim, stop here, don't stop here, it's preferable to continue, it's preferable to stop, a stop should be, you know, very brief, or maybe complete stop. All these signs that you see in the Quran, you know, these are all in a way bid'ah. It didn't exist during the days of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But we will say, and all Muslims will agree, this is for a good cause, and so it is known as bid'ah hasana, a good bid'ah. So if they come that way, you know, then it's very easy to talk to them. If we can see the second slide, didn't get chance to get actually another example here, but this is actually one page from the writing of the Quran in Kufi script. This is from Surah Ibrahim, Surah number 14. And there are 2-3 ayat there. And this is actually in the Mashhad Museum of the Imam Raza alayhi salam's Haram, the library there. And it is attributed, the writing of this Quran is attributed to Amir al-Mu'minin Ali bin Abi Talib alayhi salatu wasalam. The size is not big, so I know it's not that easy to understand. But look at the second line in the yellow background. That is at the end of the first line in the normal writing. لَيَقُومُ الصَّلَاةِ لَيَقُومُ الصَّلَاةِ فَاجْعَلْ أَفْأَدَةً مِنَ النَّاسِ تَهْوِي إِلَيْهِمْ. That's the second line there. Now you can just imagine how difficult it would be for somebody who is not, you know, used to that script to be able to read it. There's no dots, no nuqtas, you know, but this was the normal way of doing things. And it's later on that Muslims came to realize that even Arabs have problem reading the Quran if they don't know the language properly or they have not been trained. Sometimes the mistakes could be very serious. It will completely change the meaning. And therefore, you know, this whole issue of tajweed came up. It is actually known as an art or a science, ilm al-tajweed. You know, the art or the science of good reciting of the Quran. Tajweed is from, you know, jayyid, jawd, which means a good recitation of the Quran. So it became an ilm, it became an art or a science by itself, where people, you know, learn how to recite the Quran in the good way and in the proper way. I'll give you one example. Slide number 3, if you can see the Arabic writing. Look at the first line. This is from Surah At-Tawbah, the very early ayat of Surah At-Tawbah. Slide number 3, please. أن الله بريء من المشركين ورسوله. Then the second version, which is not from Quran, and somebody recited it this way, out of ignorance. أن الله بريء من المشركين ورسوله. What is the difference there? I put the color so you know, otherwise it would be difficult to even read what is the difference between the first line and the second line. The difference is only the first one has dhamma on lam and the second one has fatha on it. Such a minor difference. But you know the meaning, how it changes? Look at the translation of the first line. Allah and His messenger repudiate, you know, disassociate with the idol worshippers. It is a declaration to the mushrikeen of Makkah that Allah and Rasul have nothing to do with you now. As far as your agreements are concerned, when it comes to the end, it will not be renewed. If you look at the second version of it, the meaning changes. It means Allah repudiates the idol worshippers and His messenger. So now Allah is doing bara'at with his own messenger. Just that dhamma and fatha. And so when we talk about ilm al-tajweed, all these rules and regulations, and even the need to have the fatha and dhamma in its right place, you know, it is, even if it is a bid'ah, it is indeed a bid'ah hasana, it is a very good thing, we need it. Otherwise, people would be reciting the Quran in a wrong way. It was because of this example that Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali bin Abi Talib alayhi salatu was salam, called one of his companions by the name of Abu al-Aswad al-Du'ali. And Abu al-Aswad is known in the Arabic language to be the founder of what is known as Ilm al-Nahw. Arabic grammar consists of two subjects. One is known as Sarf and the other is known as Nahw. Sarf deals with, you know, how you take the root word and then you change it in different forms. From ilm you have ta'lim, allama, alim, ma'lum. These are all from one root. So deriving different forms in verb and nouns from the root is the function of ilm al-sarf. That's where you learn. Then there is another science called ilm al-nahw, where you learn where the fatha and zumma and kasra will come. You know, why do you say Bismillah ar-Rahman? For example, when you say kalima, you say Muhammadun Rasulullah. When you say adhan, you say Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Why did Muhammad there was Muhammadun and here it became Muhammadan? Or when you say Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin. So why is dun, dan, din? This is where you have to learn ilm al-nahw. You know how the sounds will come up. And these two sciences, especially ilm al-nahw, Arabs, of course, existed long time before Islam. Arabic language existed, but this was an oral language. There were no books talking about the grammar of Arabic language. People will just learn one generation from the other. The first person to put these rules of Nahw in a written form was Abu al-Aswad, and he did it under the instructions of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali bin Abi Talib alayhi salatu wasalam. And so even this system of, you know, reciting the Quran in the right way and to have this i'rab in the right places can be, you know, traced back to the contribution of our imam. As far as the bid'ah is concerned, bid'ah hasana, you know, now it's not only in the written form, you know, alhamdulillah, Quran is available in all different forms, whether it's audio cassettes, that's obsolete now. Then we have the CDs and MP3 formats and different apps, the services which are there on internet now, especially if you go to the Flash Quran or QuranFlash.com, you can actually read the Quran, the version that you are used to. You can flip the page on the screen itself. So, you know, it might be interesting to teach the kids the Quran in that way. They might find it more interesting according to their own age and, you know, modern age. These are all, and even this whole system we hear about online Quran classes, as well as people who have this on telephone. You know, we get people calling, you know, we are there available to teach your children Quran. We say, you know, my children are grown up. But we get these calls, ads, you know, every second day. They have a list, it seems, of all Muslim households in Canada, calling sometimes from India and Pakistan. But the point is that you have all different ways of learning how to read the Quran, which is the beginning of the process of learning to understand the Quran. And all these different ways, you know, there is no problem at all. Because all these innovations or the new methods are to facilitate the correct recitation of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So there's no problem there, rather there is thawab and reward in facilitating that process in whatever way that we can. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to understand the Quran, to learn it in the right way, and to live our life according to the values and teachings of the Quran as preserved and taught by the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu was salam.